ओके यस सर, यस सर, यू कैन कीप योर कैमरा ऑन। गुड इवनिंग सर। So you are not audible.
Also, sir, could you please turn on the lights? You are not clearly visible either. Yes, sir, that's better, sir. Thank you.
Should we start?
Wait a moment until people come in and join on the YouTube live. I'll let you know.
Okay. सर, हेलो सर, एम आई ऑडिबल? हेलो सर, एम आई ऑडिबल?
सर यू आर नॉट ऑडिबल सर। No, sir, your mic isn't working, sir. So, could you try without using your earphones?
हेलो सर, जस्ट अ मोमेंट। Yeah. Hello, sir. Okay, sir has left the meeting. Hello, sir. Yes. Sir, am I audible to you?
Fantastic. I think he has some internet issue. Wow.
Dude, NCL mein sab jagah pe internet ka issue aata.
You do realize na ki all of this is going live?
Oh, no. Okay. I'm going to just be
saying this.
Yeah. But I think it's only our people who are watching it.
We have 30 people watching right now.
Okay, no, they don't want to see my face.
Yeah, so you think you want to try calling sir and asking him ki kya hua?
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. Text. Okay. Sir, can you hear us? Sir, your mic is off. Sir, you're still not audible. He wants 5 minutes.
Hello, sir.
Yeah, am I audible now?
Yes, sir, you're audible now.
Yeah, okay, great. Can we start?
Yes, sir, we can start the session.
So just a moment. Good evening, everyone. I hope everyone is in good health. I'm glad all of you could make it. I am Anjali Trimukhe. I'm a second year student from BJ Medical College. I'm also a member of the networking team of BJ GMC Research Committee. Today we have with us Dr. Dharne. Dr. Dharne is a principal scientist and an associate professor at the National Collection of Microorganisms. NCL Pune. He was a research scientist at the National Institute of Virology Pune. He was a postdoctoral fellow at the University of Maryland, USA. He was also a visiting scientist at the United States Department of Agriculture, USA. He is currently working on a Government of India project on Ganga River microbiome using metagenomics. He helped in the upgradation of NCIM facility that led to significant earning of cash flow of 20 crores. He has received the 2018 Endeavors Executive Fellowship hosted by RMIT University in Melbourne, Australia. Along with this, he also has 54 publications and 4 patents. He has also taken up multiple extramural projects. Welcome, sir. We are honored to have you here with us. I request everyone to put up their questions in the comment section. Yes, sir. I request everyone to put up their questions in the comment section and we will address them towards the end. Let us start without any further delay. So you can take over.
Sir, you aren't audible, sir.
Yeah, just give me a minute. I will start the presentation. Slide. Can you see? Can everybody see the slide?
Not yet, sir.
Not yet. Now,
yes, sir.
Yeah, you can see. Glad that it worked. So now we need to put in slideshow from the beginning. Okay, perfect.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Very good evening to all of you. who have connected through different platforms. And thanks to DJ GMC group for asking me whether you are interested to discuss some of your research findings and research journey with our medical students. And immediately, without any delay, I accepted the invitation. Thanks to Anjali and thanks to entire this research club. So today I'm going to present a very interesting aspect, which is probably very close to any doctor, or I would precisely say this is the one of the burning problem in entire world. The title of today's presentation is this antimicrobial resistance from a microbiologist perspective, stomach to environment. So as told to me that I need to touch upon myself and my journey in this scientific journey. So my entire education, schooling, degree, pre-degree and post-graduation happened in Maharashtra state only. So coming from a rural background and going through these all important institutes during education was very important to nurture the scientific mindset. Then I landed into Aurangabad for post-graduation education in biotechnology. Then I moved to Pune, Vidya Nagari what they call, and where I joined National Center for Cell Science in Pune University campus for my PhD studies. And you can see on right hand side my PhD supervisor. And the title of my PhD thesis was characterization of UDS positive bacteria from human gastric dish. Now you could have got the idea that I did during my PhD, I worked on these gastric microorganisms. So mainly you can see these two gentlemen. One is was associated with DJ Medical College earlier, Professor Kakrani, whom so I used to visit your college very frequently, rather every alternate day, to get these biopsies and to do further studies. Then another gentleman is from Motilal Nehru Medical College, Allahabad, who was also one of the important contributor in giving us samples for these studies. So after these studies, I moved to further studies to...
Sir?
Yeah.
Sir, sorry for interrupting, but your PPT isn't moving, sir.
Now it is moving?
No, sir. Could you try pressing full screen on it again, sir?
Is it okay? Moving?
Sir, it hasn't become full screen yet, sir.
Really? Full screen shortcut, anybody knows?
Sir, up in the top left corner, play from current slide, sir.
From current slide. Now it is okay. Can you see?
Yes, sir, we can see the page, but it isn't full screen yet, sir. I think you can continue if it is visible. Sir, one moment. Technical team, is it visible?
Okay. Let me... Let me load slides again.
Okay, sir.
Now I think it will be visible. Show from beginning. Can you see
yes, sir.
Slide?
Yes, sir.
Can you see? Oh, yeah, yeah. There is some issue. Now, visible?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Slide yes, number 3? Yeah, okay. Sorry, probably there are a lot of hurdles today because I'm using some other's computer.
It's all right, sir. Yeah. It's visible.
Yeah. So, during doctoral studies, I mostly focused on this human gastric microorganisms. We very well know that Helicobacter pylori is the major pathogen for causing gastritis, gastric ulcer, and ultimately leads to gastric cancer like malignancy. So the very peculiar of this study, why I'm explaining detail, because our entire presentation is going to be linked with this this study only. So everybody knows that Helicobacter pylori is a major pathogen in gastric cancer, but incidentally, you know, PhD comes with a very surprising discoveries, where we found some other bacteria were present in the gastric niche, which we isolated and characterized further. So I'll touch upon that story. Anyway, entire story is based on this one only. Further, after PhD, I moved on to postdoctoral studies abroad, where I joined my first postdoctoral assignment at US Department of Agriculture in Maryland. So where I worked on this foodborne microorganisms. So as we know that food safety is one of the major concerns in underdeveloped, developing and developed nations. And foodborne outbreaks are very common in Western countries. So there I worked with this government lab with Indian mentor for about 3 years. And then I moved to University of Maryland School of Medicine. You can see Professor Das Sharma is on the right hand side, who was my postdoctoral mentor for second PhD, where I worked mostly on these halophiles. Now, what are halophiles? In a very simple way, if you are following social media, you have seen in last 3-4 days, Lonar Lake is becoming pink, right? So these are nothing but these are probably because of halophiles which are growing in, got opportunity to grow in such environment in last 3-4 months, kind of environment prevailing in and around Lonar Lake, India. So that pinking is caused by halophiles. So we studied that bacterium during my PhD work. Then eventually I moved to NCL in 2012 at NCIM Resource Center at NCL, like Anjali mentioned just before some time. And this is my group. Usually this slide comes in the end, but I prefer to put my students in for forefront of the discussion. You can see most of the dissertation students I have not included. These are some representative students. Couple of them have passed out and couple of them will be passing out soon, and some of them are still working with me. Now, after my brief introduction, let us move to today's important aspect of antimicrobial resistance. Many people call it as antibiotic resistance also. Another term is drug resistance or MDR. So frequently you might be hearing even microbiology classes like MDR is a global concern, MDR or multi-drug resistance, especially in case of TB and other pathogens like Klebsiella, Acinetobacter or hospital acquired infections. Antimicrobial resistance is a global challenge, and it's a major challenge in developed nations like UK, Europe and other major economies. Now we are witnessing, probably we are witnessing from last 3-4 months, like how this epidemiology or infections can damage the major economies in the world. So let's come back to today's discussion, antibiotics and the resistance and global health concern, and then how we are linked to the environmental spread of antimicrobial resistance. As we know, you might have studied in your 12th class or in last couple of years of your MBBS degree that antimicrobial resistance spreads in a very different kind of mysterious way, I would call, by spread through primary infection, then resistant infection, because you consume antibiotic after primary infection and 100% bugs don't die. Some of them are survivors, like you can see in the red color. Then these survivors rather proliferate and start growing on that antibiotic itself, which we call as phenomena as antimicrobial resistance. Because whatever drug you put, they consume and they can grow very nicely. So such drugs will become less effective or ineffective with regular usage, and that's why there is a rapid or huge demand for new drugs or new antibiotics in at global level. Here you can see the discovery of antibiotics from 1932 to 2000, very latest. You can see here after say 1950 or 1960, the antibiotic discoveries have become really slowed down. Probably there is a reason that during Second World War they felt the need of more antibiotics. So in First and Second World War, most of the antibiotics, like classical antibiotics like penicillin, tetracycline, ampicillin, they were discovered. And these come from microorganisms. Like very famously, you might know actinomycetes are the major source of these antibiotics. Like streptomycin, you can see here, it comes from streptomyces species. Now, how antibiotic resistance is disseminated in the environment? Environment may be any environment. Our body itself is also an environment. Outside river is also an environment. Your house floor, even our air conditioning systems, these are all environments. So what happens? So these bacteria, they possess extracellular, extra chromosomal DNA, which is known as plasmid. So these plasmids act as our helmets, you know, for in a layman language. So you remove and you give it to the next person, he can wear and go. So these plasmids can be inherited through one bacteria to another bacteria, through say wastewater sewage effluent or wastewater treatment plant, and even in the medical environment like hospital environment. See, this is what this slide indicates, how it is spread. You know, hospital and industrial waste which goes in the water body, sometimes treated, sometimes partially treated, and then that water comes in a recycle, wastewater purification. We have seen that that in urban settings like cities, that river water is also given to the closest this agriculture fields which are adjoining this lake, river flow. Okay, and these huge antibiotics and other toxins are released in the river water or aquatic system, which again indirectly comes in our system. You can see that the cycle is completed. So whatever is going through anthropogenic activities, that means the man-made activities, is again coming back to us in a different form. So nature is very smart. So you can see here a selection of antibiotic resistance bacteria from in the environment, and antibiotic resistance bacteria coming in the human body or human microbiome. So there is a very clear-cut connection between humans and environment. So more we pollute, more we get back. That is very simple and very straightforward. Now with this all, so antibiotic resistance is not a new problem. From last 4 or 5 decades, entire globe is coming together to work on antibiotic resistance or resistome, what we call. Broadly we call now it as a resistome. So everything is ome, like microbiome, metagenome, like this. So so Human Microbiome Project was started by National Institute of Health, USA, and where the aim was to map the microbiome from entire human body. Oh, okay. So skin, nostril, hair, oral cavity, esophagus, stomach, gut, colon, and many other parts. And to correlate this microbiome with healthy or disease status. Because as we know, whenever you say you travel to a very different part of the country or world, you get stomach upset. It's nothing but your microbiome has changed and your body needs some time to adapt to such kind of change the food habits or change environment. So here you can see this study was published in a very prestigious journal like Genome Research, and huge amount of data was generated. So this is all American study. Then similar kind of study was also started in Europe, which is called as MetaHit, that is metagenomics of human. What is metagenomics? It is nothing but to understand the complete microbiota present in any sample. If you are studying fecal sample, so you call fecal microbiome or fecal metagenome. If you are studying soil sample, it is known as soil metagenome. Meta means everything. Genome means DNA or RNA. And omics means it's a tool, like metagenomics or microbiomics. These are different tools. So here you can see oral cavity has very peculiar kind of microbial profile. Then stomach has obviously, I just told you the Helicobacter pylori. Everybody listening to this talk, everybody's stomach has H. pylori, and that bug is also listening to this talk. So only that, why it doesn't attack on our system, because it depends on the immunity. Even we all are carrier of Mycobacterium tuberculosis, but we are like, we have developed herd immunity or the natural immunity to this bacteria. So herd immunity, by saying that, you will immediately recollect the ongoing pandemic crisis, right? Then coming to small intestine, you can see very different kind of microorganisms are present, because these all microbes are adapted to that particular environment. So environment is acidic, like stomach, which is acidic and very less oxygen. Intestine is very different ballgame. The environment is totally different. So you can see a very different kind of profiles are present. Here you can see the pH gradient on your right side. Stomach is very acidic, almost fully acidic. Then gut becomes more to the near to the neutrality. So you can see the microbiota is increasing on right hand side. Microbial biomass is increasing. So very interesting studies were published, and mostly this data was used in the medical field for understanding the healthy and disease status of the individuals. Now, after understanding complete human microbiome or human body microbiome, let us focus our discussion on the stomach. Okay, so stomach, as I mentioned, it is a very acidic pH. It has a microaerophilic environment, means very less oxygen is there. A lot of urea is pumped there. Okay, and also it has antibacterial or bactericidal compound, which is nitric oxide. So usually in stomach, we know that whether there was a lot of controversy whether stomach is sterile or bacteria are present or nothing is present. So you can see the two gentlemen who received Nobel Prize in Medicine in 2001, Robin Marsh, Warren and Marshall. These are two Australian physicists, they are doctors, physicians, who discovered first time this bug in the stomach. And that time, I can tell you very interesting small story without wasting time, that the person on the right hand side, Marshall, so he isolated this microorganism on the plate. So he plated the biopsy contents, and there was some kind of long holiday, and he did not come to lab, like what we are experiencing right now. And when he came to lab, he saw very funny colonies were growing on the culture petri plates. And when he saw that these samples were from gastric niche, and then he rushed to publish these studies in a very reputed journals like Lancet. That time Lancet was Lancet, everybody knows this these days, especially the medical students and medical fraternity. So he has to show that these whatever creatures he has found on the media, they are causing infection. So he drank the culture. उसने कल्चर पी लिया एंड ही डेवलप द अल्सर. दैट्स वॉट इट वॉज प्रूवन दैट यस दिस एक्स बग इज कॉजिंग गैस्ट्रिक कॉम्प्लिकेशन एंड इट इज कमिंग फ्रॉम गैस्ट्रिक. सो इन मेडिकल माइक्रोबायोलॉजी वी कॉल दिस टर्म एज कॉच पॉस्टुलेट. सो रॉबर्ट कॉच हैज डिस्कवर्ड दिस कॉच पॉस्टुलेट. सो फ्रॉम देयर द स्टडी स्टमक इट इज बिलीव दैट स्टमक इज नो मोर स्टराइल. Habits diverse microflora including Helicobacter. So there are different manifestations associated with H. pylori. Many people, they get enteral gastritis or mild gastritis or corpus related gastritis. So, and also hyperchlorohydria, like very heavy acidity in the stomach. So to better understand this talk, talk is related mostly to acidity and other things. Then hypochlorohydria. So So in some cases there is a less secretion of hydrochloric acid in the stomach, so that is known as hypochlorhydria. Whenever there is less acid, more microorganisms will grow. When there is hyperchlorohydria, very less microbes will grow and more mostly Helicobacter will grow. Why? You can see it on left hand side, because lower gastric acid production leads to growth of other microorganisms which adapt and colonize in the stomach, and they also start developing acid resistance, right? So lot of studies are reported in understanding stomach microbiota. Mostly they are like, you can see here, corpus, antrum, then gastric is causing, dyspepsia causing. So there are people, researchers have used different methods to understand this gastric microbiome. Here you can see a very, so the thing which is highlighted here is Acrobacterium. What is it? You'll see next. So what is Acrobacterium? As I mentioned during my doctoral studies, we isolated these unusual microorganisms from the gastric niche, and we wanted to see whether they are taking advantage of less acidity in the stomach, and they are also growing with Helicobacter. That's where this study was started. Then we looked at the literature. We dig out complete literature. Then we saw that this Acrobacterium is present where it was reported. So here you can see it is ubiquitously present. It is present in the polluted river also. It is also present in the soil as plant growth promoting microorganism. And also it is present in the medical or clinical setting. That two major pathogens of this genus, that is Anthropy and Intermedium, they are known to report bacteremia and other infections in immunocompromised patients. So it is ubiquitously present in different kind of environments. So down the line, during my study, what we did, so we first published this case report of Acrobacterium species from Indian patient, and eventually we isolated various strains from different patients, as I mentioned, from Pune individuals, from Allahabad, and also from Hyderabad, that is comprising covering maximum of geographic part of India. And the two strains that here you can see, M86 and 229E, were taken for further study. Yeah, so this is present throughout everywhere. So what were our objectives? So we want to study the diversity, whether they are diverse or they are not diverse. So if they are diverse, then it's a problem. Like we can see the clusters of COVID, different clusters are moving different countries and different things. So that is known as diversity. And to understand the genomic level analysis of these strains, to understand whether they are specialized to the stomach niche or is there any different thing. Also, we want to understand their gene expression. What do you mean by gene expression? So when I grow a particular bacteria in different media or different culture media, or say different temperatures or different pH or different salts, and understand their profile, functional profile, how they behave, understanding the that is known as expression, how they express themselves. So we'll touch upon that. And the main third objective was to understand the link between human associated microorganisms and their antibiotic resistance or their presence in the wastewater stream. These were broadly three objectives. So this first objective we published in 2007, where my PhD student he published this paper, Understanding Genetic Diversity. So we took almost 200 plus isolates from different geographic regions of India, and then we did their antibiotic resistance profile using 28 different antibiotics, including beta-lactam, trimethoprim, kanamycin, and so on. Here you can see isolates are coming from three different zones of India. Then, as I mentioned, we wanted to study diversity. So how to study diversity? So what we did, we took an interesting approach of multi-locus sequencing. So these are, in a simple language, these are genes present, genes that are not evolved too much in bacteria. So they are known as housekeeping genes. So we took advantage of these housekeeping genes, and basically we took these all collection of 200 plus bacteria, their DNA was isolated, and these six genes were used for MLST, and they were amplified using PCR. Probably you people might have heard what is PCR, that is polymerase chain reaction. These days you hear RT-PCR for understanding or detecting positive patients, RT-PCR. So this is also a kind of PCR, that is polymerase chain reaction. And once we do the PCR, then we sequence using sequencing technique in our lab. So what we found is that, so these are different genes what we used for this MLST study. Let us not go into too much detail, only understand that they are present uniformly throughout all these genes. So what is the conclusion? So the Indian population of Acrobacterium in gastric niche, it has a multiple species, it's not a single species. Okay, so there are multiple players in this one. So what are they? Mainly they are Acrobacterium anthropi, Intermedium or Oryzae. So in this genus Acrobacterium, there are almost 21 species are present, but we could find only these three prevalent species. And also very interestingly, it indicates very low rate of recombination. That means chances of getting more drug resistance or more antibiotic resistance is very less. So they have low rate of recombination. So that means these strains are still under low virulence or low infection causing ability. Yeah, so here we did few genes. So we wanted to see what is happening at 5000 genes. But how to do that? So there are sophisticated technologies available, and we call it as genome sequencing. So take X bacteria and you profile it for 5000 sequencing. So here we used these three major sequencing platforms. Very simple. It's in simple sequencing, we detect one or two genes, and here complete genome means we dig out complete genome, like human genome, millions of genes. But in bacteria, there are 5000 or 6000 genes are present that we fish out, and then we study what is happening. That will give a more realistic picture. Very interestingly, what we did, we had a clinical isolate focusing on single isolate, and then we kept on subculturing for repeated generations to adapt in the lab. So we call it as adapted strain. So then we genome sequenced both the strains using sequencing technology in-house. So these are all technological details, let's not go in that. So what we observed, that is more important. Here you can see, so one circle indicates genome of one isolate. Okay, like this one, violet, then green, then blue. Okay, there are different. So let's see, only focus on the wherever you see the major gaps. What are these? Let's see. So in bacteria, they have two chromosomes. This picture indicates chromosome 1 and next slide indicates chromosome 2. So on chromosome 1, you can see here parental strain means which was clinical isolate, and lab adapted strain means the one which we adapted by subculturing, repeated subculturing in the lab. So what you can see, and the green is parental strain, which is obtained from patient. So you can see the green color, there is no change. Hardly merely you can see a very small negligible gaps. Even if you go on this side, you can see that yes, there are certain gaps. So let's see what is happening in the lab adapted strain. You can see the huge gaps. Here also you can see the gaps are present. So in biological term, these gaps are called as deletion. So they may have been deleted during evolutionary process. Then what we found that these deleted parts are nothing but these are patch proteins, phage proteins. Many people call it as phage also. Phage means what? These are nothing but small viral particles or bacteriophages, like viruses that infect bacteria. They are bacteriophages. So probably what our conclusion or analysis from this work was, so during subculturing or during adaptation in the lab, bacteria doesn't need those genes. So they shedded themselves. So they deleted from their genome. So probably they were not required for their survival. So this is a very interesting phenomenon which we studied here. So deletion of such segments in lab adapted strain. So such deletion, whether it leads to any function, yes, definitely there are functions associated with such genes. So what we did, a growth profile of clinical and lab adapted strain. And what we saw that there was no difference between clinical and lab adapted strain, although the lab adapted strain lost certain genes based on genomic data. Then what we did, very interestingly, as I mentioned, Nocrobacterium is a ubiquitous species present in clinical, environmental, soil, various environments. So we wanted to see whether they share same kind of genes or genomes in these different environments, or they are evolutionary, the clinical genes are different and environmental genes are different. So so the little detail we are going, there are certain terms like pan genome, core genome, right? Like pan India. Core means a particular core is very unique to particular niche. Like core means clinical strains will have only these core, and environmental will have only these. Pan means they are present throughout. So here you can see, so Nocrobacterium strains in different habitats and their distribution percentage. You can see in clinical settings, almost 30% are coming in polluted environments also. So then this is little complicated slide where we sequenced almost 15 genomes in the lab, and remaining 50 were we downloaded from the database. Let's not go in the detail of database, what are they. So we downloaded those, and then we used bioinformatic tools to compare different parameters, like you can see here, antibiotic resistant genes, metal resistant genes, because some are coming from wastewater environment, and mobile genetic elements. So this is also a little statistical slide. Let's not go in too much detail. So this is nothing but analysis of these sequenced strains. Then we plotted certain graphs to understand whether these genes are restricted to environment or clinical background. And then we draw a phylogenetic genomic analysis based on the core genes. As I mentioned, cores are very specific for niche-specific genes. And then we saw that there are some genes which are species-specific, but they are not niche-specific. That means they are present in clinical as well as environmental setup. So here you can see the environmental genes have a very huge repertoire of the genes, whereas clinical strains have very less repertoire of genes in terms of sharing between these two environments. So based on the genomic analysis, we could delineate certain annotated species to annotation species. Then we wanted, I mentioned about expression, like if you grow bacteria in a different environment, how they behave. So their behavior in terms of molecular biology is known as expression analysis. So as I mentioned, this strain was isolated from gastric environment. So we wanted to see how bacteria behaves in a different simulated gastric environment, like low pH. So what stomach contains is low pH, oxygen stress is there, that's why we use microbial. Then urea is there and antimicrobial compounds are there. So what we did, very simple microbiological experiments of growth curve we did in different nutrient rich medium, minimal media, and also media having different pH, like acidic to normal pH. Here you can see that at pH 4, strains are growing nicely. The moment you increase the pH, somehow there is a lag phase. So that means strains have adapted to this acidic environment, and they are very nicely growing in this less pH. This AGF means what? Artificial gastric fluid. Because we prepared such medium in the lab, and then we allowed the bacteria to grow, and then we see the growth profile. Similar to pH tolerance, we also studied acid tolerance, whether how they tolerate acid. Here you can see albumin standard media, pH 7. Here you can see normally growing. At pH 3.7, there is a stress and in urea, and these are different media like artificial gastric fluid. There also they are growing, and you can see the percentage survival. Although 20%, they are surviving in this environment. So this is again how we did the experiment. Basically, we used two different techniques. In this is probably you people are little aware of these technologies. This is for gene expression analysis. Usually, two techniques are used. One is microarray based array. Don't go into much detail. It gives an array, and another is RNA sequencing. Because for understanding functional gene expression, we need to isolate RNA. Like we hear these days, we isolate RNA from COVID patients, you know, for RT-PCR. From bacteria, we isolated RNA. Then we did RT-PCR to understand how these 5,000 genes are expressed in each condition. And can we correlate those genes with their phenotype, like growth? So Kushal has done this huge work, almost 1.5 to 2 year work, where this is microarray data, where you prepare the slide coated with different probes. Like 5,000 genes are present in a bacterial genome. These are all spotted on a slide and then hybridized using the RNA sample. And then using certain software, we understand whether genes are active or not active. So whichever are active, we call it as upregulated. Which are not active, we call it as downregulated. So these are RNA was isolated from these different conditions at normal pH, acidic pH. The nutrient depleted media at acidic pH. So and then what we found? So genes were like flagella. Flagella means bacteria are two types: motile, non-motile. So those motile bacteria, they need flagella, and then ABC transporter. These are certain transporters which are required to secrete the drugs or any metabolites outside the cell. And there's obviously stress related proteins and urease gene cluster. This is statistical data again. And what we did, these, as I mentioned, flagella related genes, urease related genes and stress response genes. So we validated them using RT-PCR, because this everything is predictive. Unless you validate, that data will not be complete. So we validated these genes in same conditions, whether they are really upregulated as indicated in the expression data. Yes, so they were correlated with gene expression data using in lab also. So they have a different, it appears that acid response, because they are surviving in the acid pH, acidic stomach. Probably they are using this machinery of protease and endopeptidase genes, and flagellar synthesis also is very important during this survival in the acid resistance. So for the first time, we have shown with such non-helicobacter related bacteria, they use three different strategies to survive acid resistance mechanism. That is by urease gene, which codes for urease enzyme. And once that urease gene is there, it converts urea into ammonia. And that's how the situation becomes favorable for that bacterium to grow in the acidic stomach. Then what Kushal did further, my student, what he did further, he has cloned this urease gene cluster from this bacteria into E. coli. E. coli is a very standard laboratory strain which is used to study to produce more proteins. So he expressed this urease gene, and also he expressed allantoinate amino hydrolase in this E. coli. And then we saw once this E. coli gets these different genes, what happens to its growth pattern? So we screen those colonies in acidic pH containing with and without urea, where we can see this E. coli, where it has these urease gene cluster, they grow nicely as compared to the strains which don't have these genes, like urease and Alan Pettit, my daughter told us. These two genes were previously reported in for E. coli survival in acidic environment. So probably our strain is also using the same mechanism to survive, to adapt in the gastric environment. So this is what we discuss, what is happening inside, you know, in the stomach, what is happening when there is more acid or less acid, how these bugs are behaving. Yeah, but these bugs down the line, when they pass through the gut and they shedded through fecal, they go in the environment. Then what happens? Whether they contribute to the resistance in the environment or not. That was our aim, to link such antibiotic resistance microorganisms in the wastewater environment. That is what the linking to the title, that in and out of antimicrobial resistance. So there are, again we go back to the literature and what we saw that, yes, the wastewater environment is highly polluted environment, where we see that where we see multi-drug resistant bacteria growing in the environment. This is study from Pune itself, Mula Mutha River. And sewage also reflects microbiome of human population, obviously, because most of the wastewater is also going to this, through this stomach samples or through the fecal matter. So very interestingly, what we see here is that there are three rivers in Pune, Mula, Mutha and Pavana, and all are polluted. So this is Times of India article in 2018. And so we took advantage of this article and we saw that, hey, can we sequence this wastewater genome or microbiome and see whether it has antimicrobial resistance genes coming from humans. So what we did, we collected different water samples from this river, or say domestic wastewater or sewage samples from different areas like Alandi, then near to Ganesh Kind Pune University from Range Hill area, then in Baner and area in Pune Municipal Corporation. And we profiled, first them for different heavy metals and antibiotics. So what we find that heavy metals are not, they are in the permissible limits as per Maharashtra Pollution Control Board, no issue. However, you can see the antibiotics. You can see here, these are in mg per liter. So as of now, there is no guideline of presence of such antimicrobial chemicals or antibiotics in the aquatic environment. You can see here the red highlighted ampicillin is very nicely present in the Alandi sample and also in certain regions of PMC. Amoxicillin, it is very nicely present in various parts of this Pune and Pimpri-Chinchwad Municipal Corporation samples. Same way Cephalosium, you can see here somewhere we could see 62 mg per liter. So there are these antibiotics are present in the wastewater environment. Then we isolated DNA from these samples and then we sequenced using our sequencing technology for understanding what kind of microbes are present in this water and sediment sample. So here you can see the S1 to S10 are our locations and samples, and these different colors represent different microorganisms. So you can see here, this blue indicates proteobacteria. You can see here actinobacteria like Streptomyces and Nitrospira. So different bacteria, huge diversity of bacteria we could find. And this is more refined slide where you can now see Pseudomonas, Aeromonas. These are all, Aeromonas is diarrheal causing strain. Then Acinetobacter is a hospital medically important strain. Then Propino Vibrio is there, yeah. So various pathogens we could see, and most of these are reported from human microbiome data also. These are statistical parameters, let's not go into much detail. So along with this microbial profiling, we also profiled resistance genes like resistome in these samples. Here you can see that multi-drug resistant category is highly prevalent in each sample, irrespective of location. Right, and these are heavy metal resistant genes. Here you can see even genes giving response to arsenic, copper, they are present uniformly in all the samples. And genes are under different category like transposase, recombinase. These are nothing but they can spread the resistance in a particular environment from one bacteria to another bacteria. Also, what is the conclusion? The classification of such virulence genes indicated that they were abundantly correlated with this bacterial motility, iron uptake, and different secretion systems. Most of these genera were common habitant of human gut. So, therefore, it highlights the function of wastewater as a reservoir and vehicle of virulence-related factors. So, what you can see here that, yes, human gut microbiome can be seen as a mirror image in the wastewater. So most of things are coming from human-related activities. That's how that's how a microbiologist sees this antimicrobial resistance coming, contributing from human to the aquatic environments. So we studied this using metagenomics aspect and also characterizing and profiling heavy metals and different concentrations of antibiotics in the wastewater environment. So we detected human gut microbiota, which is related to antibiotic resistance in these wastewater samples. That indicates that human activities are driving this transmission of organisms. So here, the antimicrobial resistance or antibiotic resistance talk ends. So I would like to touch upon a very interesting aspect what we did at MCL during this last 3 months lockdown. Me and my colleague Dr. Sayed, so we were working on this development of different surgical masks for this COVID-19. So very interestingly, so we used this cellulose coated material to coat the mask material, and very interestingly this coating is very interesting in prohibiting microorganisms entering through the mask. So it has almost 99.9% bacterial filtration efficiency, and this technology of coating was licensed to one of the Pune local company, that is MSME company, that is Set Lab India. Now, so the beauty of this mask technology is that masks are affordable, and already masks are being sold on the medical center and also in hospitals. So finally, these are certain happy moments where our study gets published and students are happy. And also, we also organize training programs every year, and we call master students, faculties, doctors, scientists all over India to learn about these, understand the microbial preservation methods and identification methods using gene as well as genome sequencing, and what are different techniques to identify any bug. So it is very useful for medical microbiologists also. Because eventually, if you isolate a particular bacteria or fungus in your lab, which is highly drug resistant, or you need to know which is this bacterium, and accordingly, you will prescribe certain antibiotics based on its identity. So the identification is very important when it comes to the diagnosis. So here I stop, and I'll be happy to discuss any questions.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much. It was a very informative session. Sir, we have a few questions from our audience. So, how did you develop interest in this particular field of research?
Wow. So, probably as a natural instinct, as I mentioned, that was a journey that took me from bachelor days to master, and then. So it's part of your interest. Developing interest in science is also interest driven, what I call. If you start thinking that yes, I may have interest in different area, but when I came across working with these microorganisms, then I slowly developed interest to understand more at a deeper level, like molecular level, how they are behaving, how they are expressing themselves in a different environments. That's where the scientific intuition was driving.
So also what
options? And it's an addiction, by the way.
Yes. Yes, sir. Another question. What obstacles did you face in this journey and how did you overcome them?
Patience should be there. Obstacles are where many obstacles, but the patience is something which is very important in a scientific field, because you encounter simple experiment is going on and you encounter a lot of problems. So patience is the key to the success in science. Patience, follow up. Rather, I would say patience, mainly patience, and your temper.
Thank you, sir. Another question. What difference did you see in the research conducted in US and in India?
Very good question. So, say, when 9 to 10 years back, when I was doing postdoc studies abroad, then I used to think that, yeah, really, those countries are doing marvelous in terms of technology or getting science published in a very high impact journals, where probably India was not. That's what my thinking was. But when I came back to India, say in 2013-14, my view was totally changed, because Indian science was also progressing equally well. Only thing is that sometimes we have limited resources, unlike Western countries. But definitely a research passion or the way research is conducted in Western countries is a very focused kind of way, I would say. And also very good generous support from the government and other things. And also they are very much open for foreign nationals to visit their country and do the research. And now I could see that like students like me who went abroad 1 or 2 decades back, they are coming to the motherland and they are serving India, and now we are bringing that culture in India, that Western culture, what we call Western culture of science, research, what kind of passion you need, what kind of planning is required whenever you want to do a research. Probably the planning, passion we have a lot of energy, enthusiasm, intelligence we have, only proper planning and executing the research probably was lacking. I do not know now. Now looks like situation is much better improved in the last decade in India also, in terms of research. But definitely worth going abroad for taking certain specific specialized training. That may add to your skill sets. That's what I think.
Yes, sir. Thank you. And sir, the audience is mostly comprised of students who are interested in research. So what advice would you like to give to them?
Come in the research. There is no limit. I could see many doctors. When I was doing postdoc in University of Maryland in School of Medicine, I could see a lot of doctors. They were very much devoted to the research, even after their OPD and other things are over, they could come in the lab and start doing their projects related to whatever, virology or bacteriology, any other stem cell biology, different things. So research is a sort of addiction, I would call. So it is not limited to doctors that, oh, I'm a doctor, no, I may not get time after my education or duties. But research is something is passionate about, one should be passionate about, even your main priority is to serve society. But research is very important. You never know when situation will arise, which is arising today, where we need a lot of doctors who have hands-on experience in handling clinical samples or pathogens or, you know, a different kind of biosafety level laboratories. So I would urge that doctors in this fraternity or field should definitely come in the research and work with non-doctor scientists like us. That way it will be a win-win situation, because some things in our field probably you people don't know, and some crucial micro levels details in your clinical field probably we are not aware of. So it's a win-win situation if doctors and scientists come together. So scientist becomes doctor, doctor becomes scientist. One plus one becomes 11.
Yes, sir. So thank you so much. Thank you for giving us your valuable time and sharing your knowledge and experience. I would also like to thank Dr. Aarti Kinikar, ma'am. She is the advisor of Jigyasa BJGMC UG Research Club. I would like to thank our council and the teams for making this event a success. And a very big thank you to our audience to having stayed connected even after the technical issues that we faced. Thank you so much, everyone. Stay tuned. We will be conducting sessions from the 22nd on biostatics. So we will be posting them on our Instagram and to other accounts. Please stay tuned. Thank you so much. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Also, Anjali.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, there are a few questions from our YouTube page. Would you like to ask them to sir as well?
Okay. Fine.
Sure.
I've sent them to you.
Okay. So one question from Varun Patkaltwar. Is the secretion of acid dependent on the amount and type of microflora in the gut and vice versa?
Acid secretion depends on microflora as well as your food habits. What we saw in our study that the non-vegetarian eating populations had more acid secretion as compared to vegetarian or fiber eating population. So it is both ways, because microbes also they have metabolic system and they also produce acid as a part of their metabolic pathways. But however, the acids coming through your dietary habit or food also adds to the acidity in the stomach. That's why suddenly if you eat different or some different thing which you usually don't eat, you feel little acidic. You say that आज मुझे मेरा स्टमक एसिडिक लगा, यू नो. सो योर फूड हैबिट आल्सो कंट्रीब्यूट्स टू द एसिडिटी. नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन वी कैन टेक. कैन वी टेक नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन?
हेलो.
यस सर.
Yes, sir. We have another question. Yes, sir. So, how to implement the antimicrobial stewardship program in order to control increasing antimicrobial resistance in aquatic animals? And what are your opinions regarding it?
Yeah, so very good question. So, this comes in the management of antibiotic resistance crisis. So especially in animal husbandry, I would call, we take a different example where say like a poultry or aquaculture industry where a lot of antibiotics are used for making healthy birds, because its ultimate market is to sell healthy birds for food consumption and other things. So because of this, unknowingly these antibiotics go in the environment and also probably through consumption it goes in the consumer system also. So therefore use of less antibiotics and moving towards green methods like using probiotics or prebiotics or combination of pro and prebiotics would be useful to minimize the dose of antibiotics used. That way you minimize their secretion in the environment. Go green.
Yes. So the last question.
Yeah.
When an organism acquires resistance to a drug, do we use other drugs? And is it possible that the organism loses the resistance gene if we are not exposing the organism to the first drug at all?
No, organisms have very good immunity or memory, I would call, not immunity, memory. So today use one antibiotic and stop and use another one, it would still have memory of previous antibiotic. It's not that memory has erased. So whenever you bring that earlier antibiotic in the future, definitely it would have developed that memory, what I call in the bracket resistance. So you mean to say alternate antibiotic therapy, it will not work. It won't work. In fact, you are calling or you are inviting more problems by using another antibiotic. Who knows, that antibiotic also has some connection with the previous antibiotics. Because mode of action of most of the antibiotics is on cell wall. So who knows, you might be inviting more trouble.
Thank you so much, sir. Again, I would like to thank you and the Jigyasa BJGMC Research Club and Dr. Kinnikar, ma'am. Thank you so much for sharing your experience with us, sir.
Thank you all. Thank you, Arti ma'am. Thank you, Jigyasa Club and the listeners who are listening to the talk. And I'm very much thankful for inviting me to this and share my journey. In fact, I went into my student days, and that was really very nice, session for me in the last 1 hour or so, interacting with you people, especially from this medical background.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. So I disconnect or?
Yes, sir. Yes,
yeah, you can disconnect. Okay, thank you. Yeah.
Thank you.
Have a good day.